Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'm Josefine Stark. And for my presentation today on the topic of forgiveness, I've collected some interesting teachings as inspiration to guide us onto the next level in this area. A friend of mine once handed me a sheet of paper with the title on it, "It Takes One to Know One." And I'd like to share a couple of quotes from it. First was the question, "Does it help to talk about it if you notice a negative trait in another?" And the response was, and this response was given by Jesus through his messenger in 1984, "No. It merely compounds the problem and you take on the karma." Ugh. So think about that before you talk about someone. Another item on this sheet, "It Takes One to Know One," was a teaching given in the early 1980s at the Ashram of the World Mother. And this is actually very much like the Ho'oponopono. It said, "Imperfection is drawn to our attention for one reason, alchemy. Your holy Christ self, that's your higher self, literally has people standing in line to demonstrate what is in your electronic belt, that is, your misqualified substance. Once that substance is no longer present in your own belt, if when you no longer have that, you will not notice it in the world of another." And that was from the class of the cosmic clock in the early 1980s. And this is very similar to the Ho'oponopono, saying that once you remove something from yourself, it is also removed in the other person. So, anyway, now you can see why the paper was titled "It Takes One to Know One." I believe the advice given at that time, if you notice a negative trait in another, was to call to that person's higher self to erase or clean up that trait and replace it with the God positive quality, and to also call to your own higher self to do the same thing for you so that it could also be removed from you, because when it's removed from you, then you will not see it in someone else. Someone once made a very interesting observation that we all want mercy for ourselves and justice for everybody else. I remember at a lecture on the Kabbalah a long time ago, and it was talking on the origins of evil. And in the Kabbalah, it says that evil began when justice became more important than mercy. When I attended Summit University in 1983, a young Australian man asked Mrs. Prophet, "What is the difference between mercy and forgiveness?" And she said, "They're the same thing." A couple of months ago, I walked by one of my bookcases, and automatically my hand reached out and pulled out a book. Now, it does that sometimes whenever I need to learn something or need to work on something, and now it's time and I need to find out what it is. Anyway, the book that I pulled out of the bookcase without my knowing what it was A Course in Miracles. So I thought, And I opened it up, and the first page I opened to was a really heavy-duty message on forgiveness. So I thought, oh, well, I'll try this again. So I opened it again. Different page, forgiveness. I did it again and again and again. Always, always forgiveness. So I thought, I think this is a hint. I got the point. So this is something that I need to work on to reach a higher level of understanding and practice. And I've found that whenever I need to work on something to reach a higher level, then the people in my spiritual mandala, my personal group of spiritual cohorts on the path, are usually working on the same thing. So, what are mercy and forgiveness anyway? I looked up mercy in a couple of dictionaries, and I found these definitions: forgiveness, willingness to let go, to set aside a punishment, kind or compassionate treatment of an offender, a disposition to be kind, forgiving, or helpful. When I looked up forgiveness, I found to pardon, to cease to blame or feel resentment against, remission of a debt, as in to forgive a debt, to excuse, to free from guilt or obligation. I like Oprah Winfrey's definition of forgiveness. She said, to forgive is to forget. If you haven't forgotten, you haven't forgiven. So it's no point thinking or saying the words, I forgive you, when at some level you're still holding on to what they did or what they said. But why should you forgive someone? If you think of forgiveness as being some undeserved favor extended to another, well, of course, it makes no sense. There's no point if you still see your brother or sister on the spiritual path as a sinner, as deserving of punishment, as unworthy or lesser than yourself. Instead of seeing anyone, including yourself, as a sinner deserving punishment, see that one as a child of God who makes mistakes and is worthy of correction. So who is your brother, your sister, your neighbor anyway? Well, Jesus taught us to say, our Father who art in heaven. Well, who can say our Father? Only a son or daughter can say our Father. So God's progeny must be like him, because each creature reproduces after its own kind, creates after its own kind. So when anyone says our Father, they are a son, a daughter of God. So think about this, your brother, your sister, your neighbor, your co-workers. They are the sons and daughters of God. So what does the book A Course in Miracles say on this subject? I've heard this book was dictated to a reluctant modern-day scribe by Jesus. I don't know if that's true or not. Elizabeth Clare Prophet says the book contains errors, and I agree with her. It does contain errors, but then every book that I read does. However, there is good information in the book. So I present these extracts not as perfect truths, but as food for thought, as ideas to ponder on how we can reach a higher understanding on this subject and also reach a higher level of love and forgiveness for each other. So what I've done is, for the next couple of pages, is I've strung together some quotes that I found throughout the book. Sometimes they're in the second person, and sometimes they're in the first person, depending on whether it's a teaching or a contemplation. I've also only chosen extracts that I feel are corroborated by other teachings of the Ascended Masters in other organizations. So here goes. Without forgiveness is the mind in chains. Conflict must be resolved. It cannot be evaded, denied, disguised, hidden. Forgiveness is the light to shine away all conflict. Today, I would behold my brother as sinless. Today, I would behold my sister as sinless. See my brother's sinlessness. His holiness reminds me he was created one with me and like myself. In him I find myself, that's with a capital S, my real self. Forgiveness lets me know that minds are joined. It sweeps away distortions, wipes away my illusions of separation and of sin. Only my condemnation injures me. If you can condemn, you can be injured. Condemn and you're made a prisoner. Forgive and you are freed. God would not have you suffer thus. He would help you forgive yourself. He would not leave an unforgiving thought without correction. Let mercy come to you more quickly. Don't hold it off another day, another minute. See your brother, your sister, as sinless. They are not the body. Remember, the Bible says, see no man after the flesh. Before your brother's holiness, the world is still. In him is your assurance God is here. Your brother's body shows not the Christ to you. He is set forth within his holiness. Choose then his body or his holiness as what you want to see. Your brother is a sacrament and a benediction unto you. He is the mirror of yourself, wherein you see the judgment you have laid on both of you. The Christ in you beholds his holiness. See him as what he is, that your deliverance may not be long. See no one as guilty, and you will affirm guiltlessness in yourself. Guilt is only in your mind. Project it not. With everyone whom you release from guilt, great is joy in heaven. If you did not feel guilty, you could not attack, for condemnation is the root of attack. It is the judgment of one mind by another as unworthy of love and deserving of punishment. Only the self-accused condemn. You never hate your brother for his sins, but only for your own. Whatever form his sins appear to take, it but obscures the fact that you believe them to be yours. By attacking, you assert that you are guilty and must give as you deserve. If you did not believe you deserved attack, it would never occur to you to attack anyone at all. Why should you? What would be the gain? And attack can be that small, snide remark or that little negative comment. Son of God, you have not sinned, but you have been much mistaken. This can be corrected, and God will help you. God's Son is without guilt. You may be too tempted to wonder how you can be guiltless. You are not guiltless in time, but in eternity. You have so-called sinned in the past, but there is no past. There is only now. Your guilty secret is nothing. And if you bring it to the light will dispel it. The unforgiving mind sees no mistakes, only sins. It does not question, certain it is right. The forgiving mind sees no sins, only mistakes. Return your mind to the one who is your real self, who can never sin. This is the same real self of your brother and sister too, and can never sin. Be merciful today. The Son of God deserves your mercy. Deny him not. His Father's love belongs to you. Your function here on earth is to forgive him. He is as God created him, and you are what he is. Forgive him now his so-called sins, and you will see that you are one with him. Well, that is the end of the quotations that I pulled out from A Course in Miracles. I have another little quote here. This is from the Summit Lighthouse, given by God and Goddess Meru many years ago. So it's just about three sentences here. Thus the hour has come from the Holy Spirit, and we say to you, you dare not look at one another with that looking down, that remarking about this or that. There is a blackness that descends upon you when you engage in these infractions. And what takes place, beloved, is a deadly matter, for you lose what you have gained. All that condemnation is heaped upon you in this hour. For, beloved, the earth and the ascended hosts will not carry for you this negative karma. You, above all people on earth, will know the judgment because you know it is wrong. And that's the end of the quote from the God and Goddess Meru. So, see your brother, your sister, and everyone you meet as manifestations of God's consciousness. As manifestations of God's consciousness in the physical universe. See all as holy and sinless. Makers of mistakes, yes indeed. Sinners, no. In the book I Am Discourses, Volume 3, Saint Germain said, God can only act on earth through the mind of his individualizations, which is clothed in the personalities you see about you. These personalities that you see about you are but vehicles and use of expression of this mighty individuality, which is God. And Omram Ivanov said, I think it's in the book Ye Are Gods, our higher self is none other than God. That is why, at the highest level, we are God himself. For apart from God, there is nothing. God manifests himself through his creation and through each one of his creatures. End quote. This means that all forgiveness we extend to another, we extend to God. And all mercy we extend to ourselves, we extend to God. There is only one person in the universe. Quantum physics now suggests that the basic fabric of reality underlying everything is consciousness. According to quantum science, there is only one consciousness, and it is everywhere. And we are all a part of it. We share the same consciousness. Separation is an illusion. There is only one me, one I am, and we are it. The Mayans say the new cycle of 13,000 years begins at the end of 2012, and that this cycle will see a great acceleration of unity consciousness and of awareness of our oneness. In fact, the Mayan greeting and goodbye is enlightenment, which means you are another me. So finally we know what I am the one really means. It means you are another me. You are me. In the book The Intention Experiment, Lynn McTaggart wrote about some experiments which showed that all living things emit light. And she also published experiments which show that every strong emotion, whether love, hate, anger, or whatever, produce an extraordinary effect on the light discharge of the recipient. Every last thought appeared to augment or diminish someone else's light. Negative thoughts have been proven to adversely affect even plants and the objects of our environment. To think is to affect. There is no such thing as an idle thought. Remember the story told in Betty Eady's book, Embraced by the Light. During her near-death experience, she was showing what she called a drunken bum lying in the gutter, somewhere on Earth, in one of Earth's cities. And she was told this was a very highly evolved soul who had volunteered to live a life like that in order to change one person who would look on him as he passed by. What a sacrifice for another soul. So who knows if perhaps someone we look down our nose on perhaps maybe volunteered to have those particular faults, perhaps solely for us to learn forgiveness and unconditional love. Perhaps we ourselves volunteer to embody some unsavory vice in order to be an example of overcoming, of how to get the victory. So don't feel bad if you have certain addictions or problems that you never seem to be able to get a handle on. Maybe your job is to show how it can be done and open the way for everybody else. Unconditional love is always a required course in Earth schoolroom. And I believe unconditional forgiveness is part of unconditional love. I'd like to close this presentation with a short meditation. Let us close our eyes now and think of someone who annoys us, someone who gets on our nerves. Yes, the one, you got the person. You know who I'm talking about. So let us close our eyes and see that person now. Smile at them. See them smiling at you. See their heart smiling. See your heart smiling back at their heart. You are two hearts smiling at each other. So send clouds and clouds of pink love and violet forgiveness to that one and to yourself. Perhaps you prefer to see waterfalls, huge waterfalls of light, pink, lavender, violet, surrounding that one and yourself. And who is that one? It is the I Am in form. There is only one I Am. It's the same I Am that you are. The Infinite One multiplies himself infinitely and is still only one. One times one times one is always one. God said, "Beside me there is no other. Beside you there is no other. There are no others. There are only manifestations of God's consciousness in the field of consciousness." Quantum physics says physical matter does not exist. When you get smaller and smaller under the microscope, all that's left in the end is energy, is consciousness. There is only one consciousness. The one who annoys you is the manifestation of the Infinite One in matter, evolving itself spiritually in matter. You are the Infinite One, evolving in matter, ever-increasing and expanding consciousness, increasing and expanding love, always more love, unconditional love. See that one now. See their light. See their holiness. See the light and holiness of everyone. Everyone an expression of the Infinite One. So let us close now with the Ho'oponopono prayer. I am sorry. Please forgive me. Thank you. I love you. I am sorry. Please forgive me. Thank you. I love you. I am sorry. Please forgive me. Thank you. I love you. Thank you, everyone.